Welcome to worship this morning as we gather on this fourth Sunday of Advent, and Christmas is on the doorstep. So as we come to worship today, it's wonderful that we come to be in the warmth of God's Spirit and the warmth of this place and this company of God's people, and we welcome those who join us through this live stream worship as well. May we all feel a little bit of God's presence in this day and in this time. Come to worship this morning and begin our time, I'm going to invite Mark to offer us a few announcements.
Just want to call your attention to a few of the announcements in the bulletin this week. First, Sunday school classes for both today and next Sunday, December 27th, will not be held. Regarding the Christmas Fund, you are invited to participate in a special offering of the United Church of Christ. The Christmas Fund has been caring for active and retired clergy and lay employees of the United Church of Christ for over 100 years, providing emergency grants, supplementation of small annuities and health premiums, and Christmas thank you gift checks each December to lower income retirees. Because of the COVID-19 pandemic, the need this year for the Christmas Fund is more urgent than ever. In your bulletins, there should be an envelope if you wish to donate. We also have some extra envelopes out in the narthex as well. We will have a blue Christmas service this year. This service creates a space where any loss, hurt, pain, sadness, loneliness, or uncertainty within our lives can be named. The blue Christmas service will be held tomorrow night, December 21st, at 7 p.m. Christmas Eve services this year, we will hold one service on Christmas Eve, and it's going to be at 5 p.m. We are requesting that anyone who does plan to attend, if you could please RSVP with the office. That way we'll know how many plan to be here, and it will make it a little bit easier for us to get people in and out of here that evening. There are additional announcements on the back of your bulletins. Just real quick, Sunday, January 24th has been set as the date for the annual meeting. More details on that to come in January, and there are 2021 offering envelopes available out in the narthex. So I invite you to read through the rest of the announcements, and that is it. Thank you. Please join me in the call to worship. Just when life seems cozy and comfortably predictable, unexpectedly, angels appear and point us in directions we would not have chosen. Just when we have reached the point of self-confidence and acceptance, unexpectedly, angels appear and ask us uncomfortable questions we would not choose to face. And when we have followed the pointing of angels and answered their troubling questions, and even so, we feel that things can't get any worse, unexpectedly, angels appear and remind us that all shall be well, and all shall be well, and all manner of things shall be well. The love of God works toward good in all who live in awe of God. The love of God moves toward joy in all who dare to listen for angels.
The King of Glory comes, the nation rejoices. Open the gates before him, lift up your voices. Who is the King of Glory? How shall we call him? He is Emmanuel, the promised of ages. The King of Glory comes, the nation rejoices. Open the gates before him, lift up your voices.
May we join our hearts and our voices in a time of prayer. Gracious God, who promised to send a Redeemer to your people, we confess that we have not always trusted your promise. We suspect angels and disbelieve good news. We give presents, but fail to be present with one another. We suspect angels and disbelieve good news. We socialize with friends, but fail to welcome the stranger in our midst. We suspect angels and disbelieve good news. We create commotion and refuse to receive your peace. We suspect angels and disbelieve good news. Forgive us, God, for our busyness and our lack of trust. Teach us to wait with expected patience for the fulfillment of your promise to us.
O holy child of Bethlehem, descend to us, we pray. cast out our sin and enter in, be born in us today. We hear the Christmas angels, the great glad tidings tell. Oh, come to us, abide with us, our Lord Emmanuel.
So we humbly offer this prayer, even as we are bold to pray as Jesus taught, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Siblings in Christ, hear the good news. The good news of the Advent season is forgiveness of sin and new life. Let us commit our lives to Christ's way of hope and peace. Thanks be to the Advent God who comes among us, setting us free to love and serve. As we come to light the candles upon our Advent wreath on this day, we are invited to do so by receiving the messages that were spoken by angels to many of those long ago, those who were there and nearby around the birth of Jesus. And the Palmer family will help lead us in this time of lighting our candles and hearing the messages from the angels.
The angel's message of hope to Gabriel. Zachariah, I am Gabriel. I stand in the presence of God. I have been sent to speak to you and to give you good news. These are the words I spoke to the priest Zachariah. What a hopeless, doubting, time-worth old holy man. He was still working, doing his job in the temple, taking his turn faithfully, but only going through the motions of his job, sadly without spirit. A lifetime of waiting had robbed Zachariah of his most precious dream, to have a child. Then he met me. The old priest was terrified, paralyzed with fear, until I gave him this message. Your prayer has been heard. You shall have a son. Name him John. He will get the people ready for God. Even then, Zachariah could not believe me, but wonderful things were coming his way.
An angel brought the message of hope to Zachariah.
Just brings hope to the world.
Amen.
sin is reconciled. Joyful, ye nations, rise, join the triumph of the skies. With angelic hosts proclaim, Christ is born in Bethlehem. Hark, the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King.
The angel's message of peace to Joseph in a dream. Mary's fiancé, Joseph, got a visit too. Joseph was frightened by the commitment he had made to Mary and conflicted by concern for his reputation and love for Mary and her child. While he was trying to figure things out, he had a dream. In this dream, I told him, Joseph, son of David, don't be afraid. Don't hesitate. Get married. Mary will give birth to God's son. And when she does, you will name him Jesus. God saves, because he will save people from their sins. Joseph relaxed then, and he was able to do what God asked. The message gave him peace of mind. The whole world needs peace.
An angel brought a message of peace to Joseph.
Christ, thy highest temple adored, Christ, the everlasting Lord, late in time, behold him come, offspring of the flesh, the Godhead see, hail incarnate deity, pleased that man with us to dwell, Jesus our Emmanuel. Hark, the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King.
The angel's message of joy to Mary. As frightened as Zechariah was, my visit with Mary was warm and wonderful. I greeted her with blessings and compliments. Hello, lovely maidens. God has made you beautiful inside and out. The Lord is with you and has a surprise for you. All generations will honor you because you will become pregnant and have a son whose name will be Jesus. He will be great, the Holy Son of God, and his kingdom there will be no end. Mary was confused and shocked by the enormousness of the divine message. She was an ordinary girl from Nazareth, a very ordinary town. And then gentle Mary came to realize that nothing is impossible with God. And she responded to God's joy, saying, I am the Lord's maid ready to serve.
An angel brought a message of joy to Mary.
Hail the heavenly Prince of Peace, hail the Son of Righteousness, light and life to all he brings, risen healing in his wings. Mild he lays his glory by, born that we no more may die, born to raise us from the earth, born to give a second birth. Hark, the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King.
The angel's message of love to shepherds. At the time, Caesar Augustus ordered a census to be taken. Throughout the Roman Empire, everybody had to travel to his ancestral hometown to be accounted for. So Joseph from the Galilean town of Nazareth traveled up to Bethlehem in Judea, David's town. As a descendant of David, he had to go there. He went with Mary, his fiancée, who was pregnant. While they were there at the time, she gave birth. She delivered a son, her firstborn, wrapped him in a blanket. She laid him in a manger because there was no room in the inn. There were shepherds camping in the neighborhood, and they had a night watchers over their flock. When suddenly God's glory blazed around them, and oh, they were terrified. I stood among the shepherds to give them God's message. Don't be afraid. I'm here to announce good news of great joy for everyone, everybody, everywhere. A Savior has been born in David's city, a Savior who is Messiah and Master. This is what you're looking for, a baby wrapped in a blanket, lying in a manger. As soon as I said it, a huge choir of angels joined us, and we started singing God's praise, glory to God in heaven, peace to all on earth. The shepherds returned to their flock, praising God for everything they had heard and everything they had seen.
An angel brought a message of love to the shepherds.
Jesus Christ brings love to the world.
He came down that we may have love. He came down that we may have love. Came down that we may have love, hallelujah, forevermore. He came down that we may have love. He came down that we may have love. He came down that we may have love, hallelujah, forevermore. Hallelujah.
Will you pray with me? Oh God, for the gift of this day, in all the ways in which you bring life to us, new opportunities and new beginnings, we are grateful. And now for the gift of your word, we add our gratitude and praise as we take it in. May it help to bring hope and peace and joy and love into our lives here and now, and through us into the lives of others. Now, O God, I pray that the words of my mouth and the meditations of each of our hearts may be acceptable in your sight. For you alone are our rock, and you alone our Redeemer. And for this we give you thanks and praise. Amen. I don't know if you saw this on your Facebook feeds, but I saw something like this with the meme saying, "Here's the 2020 Christmas ornament." If you take a couple of masks and fold them in a certain way and put them together with an elastic, lo and behold, you get an angel. I've seen lots of different ideas for the Christmas ornament of the year, but this was interesting and crafty, and we'll stick with this one for this time and place. It makes me wonder, though, if truly, as we think about angels and this season, that's such a powerful symbol and something that's used in our decorations, and it comes from the stories that tell of the birth of Jesus, if we do believe that there are angels among us, Or are they just something that only show up in the Bible stories and speak a long time ago? Seeing a mask or two masks made into an angel certainly makes me think about how angels might be found in those healthcare workers, particularly during this pandemic. Those who are so overwhelmed, those who are on the front lines, those who are wearied and worn, those who are fearful and concerned, those who see some of the worst. And being married to a nurse who works in a hospital, I hear the stories and I see the concerns. Indeed, maybe these people are some of the angels in our midst, those who come and care, those who come and bear words of love and actions of love, those who come to help, to heal, to comfort, to bring peace, to bring some hope. Those certainly are some of the things we might think about when it comes to our caregivers who work so hard in this time. And we certainly should keep them in our prayers, in our minds, in our hearts, in the midst of this particular time when hospitals are so overwhelmed. One of my mentors once preached a sermon and talked about angels and said how he really preferred to encounter angels from the packaging of a roll of toilet paper than he did by the way the stories came about in the Bible. And maybe that's why there's so many different moments when angels have to say to those whom they visit, "Fear not." Why wouldn't you be afraid for a little bit? This angelic presence, this unexpected moment, this heavenly being, something that you're not akin to seeing, but only imagine and think about, someone who comes to speak with a message from God. Are you in trouble? Or are you chosen? If you're chosen, what is it that God wants you to do? Do you feel inadequate and you can't take it on? Do you feel skeptical that this can't be right? You've got the wrong person. This can't be possible. This isn't the way God works. Well, if we consider Zechariah, the father of John the Baptist, if we consider Mary, if we consider Joseph, if we consider the shepherds, all of them seem to reflect some of those moments of doubt and disbelief, wonder and worry, awe and fear. All those things that get wrapped up when an angel appears in such a full and vibrant way. But then, after the fear is overcome, after the disbelief fades away, there is a trust. There is a sense of assurance. There is a sense that if God is willing to ask these people to be part of God's plan for unveiling love into the world, then they are willing to be a part of it. And if God asks them, they feel some level of comfort that it will succeed. Because God just doesn't make promises and ask people to do things through angels, through messengers, and then step away. God promises to be present and to make sure it is fulfilled. Whatever God wants fulfilled, God will make sure it is fulfilled. And what a blessing, what a curiosity, what a thing that you and I, like Zechariah or Joseph or Mary or the shepherds, might actually receive angelic words, to have messages shared with us that call us to do something, that give us hope and peace and love and joy, that spurn us on in our discipleship, that give us direction, that give us course correction, that give us security and safety, that give us assurance. These angels, these messengers that come from God, that are so present in the story of the birth of Jesus, and we don't hear of again until the resurrection of Jesus. These mysterious creatures and characters are there throughout the whole time. They're there in our midst. They're there, I believe. Their voices may be more muted. Their identities may be more veiled. But God continues to find people and ways to send messages to us. And we have that joy of receiving them. And in order to receive them, certainly what's important is to listen, to find those ways and those moments, to find those practices of faith and spirituality, to find a moment to be still, to not do the talking, to not be distracted, but to listen to the voices that might come to us. And in the midst of even all the noise in the world and many competing voices that barrage us, to listen carefully and ask, where is the word of God? Where is the voice of God in the midst of all this babble? The voices that are of love, the voices that are of hope, the voices that are of forgiveness and grace, the voices that are of inclusion and justice, I believe, are the voices that come from the angels of God. The voices that are about reconciliation, the voices that are about healing and wholeness and unity, are those that are holy and godlike voices. Those are angelic voices. There may not be wings to see or feathers strewn on the ground as if there was something around and we knew what it was but didn't see it. There may not be skies filled with them or a chorus surrounding us singing Gloria. But angels, messengers, messengers of God are all around us. And it's not just the priestly pastoral types, it's the everyday types, it's the anywhere types, it's our family and our friends, it's our neighbors, it's strangers. J. Barry Shepherd, in a collection of readings and prayers called Faces at the Manger, offers this reflection about the angels. And now, what about those angels? For they were certainly a part of the whole scene, not just a part, indeed. For as we read over once again the gospel treatments of the Nativity, it becomes clear that they were in charge. They positively directed, stage managed the entire enterprise from start to finish. It must have been the busiest few months, the most hectic, frantic time the heavenly host had ever thought of. Not to get into that old business of counting the number of angels on the head of a pin, yet I would be willing to wager that there are more angels per square inch of scripture here than anywhere before or since, at least until the end of time in the book of Revelation. What then is their role? What do these uncanny beings represent? The word angel comes from a Greek word angelos, meaning messenger. So take away the fancy trappings we find carved into the stone of old cathedrals, melted through the radiance of stained glass, stripped of halos and shining robes, the shimmering wings and harps, and what you have, in fact, is a message bearer. One who brings, who hears the word of God into the world. They speak. They speak today if we will hear them. The poet Francis Thompson wrote, "The angels keep their ancient places, turn but a stone and start a wing. 'Tis ye, 'tis your estranged faces that miss the many splendored thing." But in order to hear, we must remain open to the true mysteries of life and death and love, not run and hide deep in the forest of the facts. These facts we make so much of are simply fine as far as they go, simply fine for answering so many of our practical everyday questions. But they are far too small, too narrow, and too limited in their scope alone to describe and deal with the totality of what we experience as reality, as life within this manifold and multifaceted creation. I am convinced, as a result of hour upon hour of listening, not just for God, but also to troubled individuals, we all can and do hear such voices. We all can and do hear voices that speak of a fairer, fuller world, of a fellowship not just of men and women, black, white, and brown, rich and poor, east and west and north and south, but of all created thing, all that God has made. And somehow, someday yet, we'll praise him through this babe that comes to Bethlehem. We cannot understand them fully. Where they come from, how they reach us, the very least we can do is to wonder. And that's what Christmas really is about, wonder. In both senses of the word. We can wonder and adore at the marvel of a Savior's birth. We can wonder and explore, inquiring what this means, what all this implies for us, just where we stand within the circle of these faces at the manger, within the vast, embracing circle of the entirety of God's creation. Because as St. Paul foresees the goal and consummation of all things, this entire universe itself, from animals all the way through angels, is to be freed from the shackles of mortality and enter upon the liberty and splendor of the children of God. A cause for us to wonder, simply wonder. And in this manufactured matter of a fact, time, that may not be such a bad place to begin. Amen.
Comes in glory. Look to the one, look to the one, look to the one who comes in glory. He will be our light. He will turn the night into day, Jesus, Jesus.
He will be our Lord. He will turn all sorrow to joy.
Sing to the Lord, bless his name. Praise him above the nations. Look to the one, look to the one who comes in glory. Will come with power. He will rule all nations on earth. Jesus, Jesus.
He will shepherd all. He will take his flock in his arms.
Jesus, Jesus. Sing to the Lord, bless his name. Praise him above the nations.
Come to a time of prayer this morning. I invite us to draw together our joys and concerns, our worries and wonders, our hopes and our fears, and lift them up to God in a time of silent conversation with our Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer. And then I invite us to receive this prayer that is also penned by J. Barry Shepherd. So let us be God's people at prayer. Break in. Break into all our lives this day, Lord Jesus. Come to us as you came long ago in gentleness and tender vulnerability. Evoke in all of us that love which alone can save us and through us save your world. In this season of giving and receiving, we pause a moment to recall the gifts you bless us with at Christmas. We thank you for your snow, coming down like a quilt upon our busy world and quieting us, slowing us down, compelling us to take time to be with ourselves. For your stars, we bless your name, frosted so bright by these December nights, lifting up our eyes, raising our heads, signaling across the centuries the vastness, the infinity, the sheer and splendid glory of your creation. For your birds, we are grateful, accompanying us through this winter, brightening the grays and the whites of our landscape with flashing reds and blues, rich browns and blacks, reminding us of springtime, of birdsong, of nesting, and of summer suns. For your trees and bushes, we return our thanks. For the fragrant, lively evergreens, balsam and fir, spruce, hemlock, pine, and bitter, red and glossy holly. Primeval trees that know the depth of winter have learned to live with grace amid the cold. For children, O God, we bless you. Young lives that call us back into our truest selves, blessing us with their wonder, their games and songs, their curiosity, their needs so simply satisfied after all. And for the child in Bethlehem, your word made flesh, your love alive and mangered with us, rejoicing in our waiting hearts this holy season through each and every one of these, your gifts. For all these gifts, we bring our thanks and add a prayer for those whose blessings have been hard to find, whose joys tend to be few and far between, asking that somehow we might be a blessing to them. In the name and for the joy of the babe in the manger. Amen. Siblings in Christ, I invite you to join with me in these words of commissioning and benediction. In the beginning, God spoke, bringing light, life, and love. In the past, when life felt dark, God spoke, sometimes in God's own voice, and sometimes through angels. God speaks a message of light and life in the birth of Jesus, the Messiah. When the angel choir withdrew into heaven and the shepherds talked things over, "Come on," they said, "let's do it. Let's go to Bethlehem as fast as we can and see for ourselves what God has told us." So they left, running, and found Mary and Joseph and the baby lying in the manger. Now, let us go to the manger to receive the good news once again and find ways to share the good news with everyone.
Come here to Bethlehem. Emmanuel, come to us. rise up, rise up, Jerusalem. Sing out, ring out, sing out, sing out, Jerusalem. Rejoice, the day is near. Rejoice, O Jerusalem, and start anew. Rejoice, O Jerusalem, he comes to you.